together again. So, good morning. Please greet one another in the Lord as I still monkey around with this, okay? So, all right. So, everybody get their wood all cleaned up and everything? Nope. Lot of it out there yet. So, all right. So, as we begin this morning, we're going to have worship a little bit different today, and communion will be a little bit different, but I will announce that as we go along. So, okay. So, our announcements are in the back, and I will be gone on vacation again, my whole family with me. And so, Pastor Mark Olson will be filling the pulpit. He was actually the pastor of Open Door Church on the highway on 71 going. So he is a great speaker. So please support him. All right. All right. And our rededication Sunday is September 10th. So, and Scott.
The ad board meeting is the 14th, not the 7th.
Oh, I fixed that once on one bulletin. Evidently, I didn't pick it up. The 14th.
6:30. I do believe Justin is a policy meeting. Is meeting prior to that?
Yeah, we're gonna. Yeah, 5:45 or so. We're gonna work on policy for a little bit ahead of time.
All right. Okay. Anything else this morning then? Okay. Let's go to the Lord then, as we begin. Glad to be here. Please start out with me this morning. Greet. You ready? That's your part. Greet. Okay. Greet one another in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus' love is poured out for us like water poured into a basin.
Jesus' love.
Jesus' love shows us who we are to be and what we are to do.
Oh, very blessed we are to know such love.
Let us pray. God of second chances and new beginnings, let this be a time of preparation. Open our hearts and minds to your grace and guidance. Embrace us with your love, that we may remember with gratitude the forgiveness you have offered us time and time again. Enclose us with your grace, that we may accept this opportunity today to rise again with Christ and to move forward into new beginnings. O Lord, fill us with your Spirit, that we may live as your called servants in the world. Amen. Please, our new song is Ready to Learn Again. Here we go. God leads his dear children along.
Yes, so this is an a cappella version, and it starts like as soon as I hit go, so just be prepared for that.
In shady green pastures, so rich and so sweet, God leads his dear children along. Where the waters cool flow, bathes the weary one's feet, God leads his dear children along. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. And some through great sorrow, but God gives the song. In the night season and all the day long, sometimes on the mount where
sun shines so bright. God leads his dear children along. Sometimes in the valley, in darkest of night, God leads his dear children along. Though sorrows befall us and Satan oppose, God leads his dear children along. Through grace we can conquer, defeat all our foes. God leads his dear children along. Some through the waters, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives the song. In the night season and all the day long.
Please be seated. The presence of the Lord God is here in this place. He waits every day. He waits Sunday for us to come because he hears our voices as we worship him and as we praise him. We offer him thanksgiving and gratitude also of all the things that he has done for us as he sent his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to carry that cross. And today we come and celebrate that communion with them as they celebrated also. In the blessed name of Jesus Christ, amen. Please join today in the call to worship. Today we'll eat the bread of life and drink the wine of forgiveness. Promise of grace. We will sing spiritual songs, remember stories of old. Embrace the truth of Christ's love. Let us worship in remembrance and praise. I would ask each one to please take a time for yourself this morning with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Each soul speaks to you, O Lord, and you hear their voice, even when they do not speak out loud. You know them personally. What an amazing God you are. Please join in the Gloria Patri. Today, our lesson is on the Holy Spirit, but it is on Holy Communion most of all, as we come this morning. It's found in 1 Corinthians 11. It's the first epistle that Paul ever wrote, and he wrote it to the Corinthians. And he wrote it for correction and understanding. It was for a teaching that they have been doing things. They had been worshiping. They have been having communion together and celebrating together. But Paul warns them that the way they are celebrating and what they are doing is not according to God's plan and what he wants them to be doing. So we start in 1 Corinthians 11. And this comes a little bit later, but I thought it was important to start at the beginning of it. It says, examine yourself. How are you taking communion? You'll find out why that question is asked in the next part here of how we do take communion. But you are the only ones that know how your heart is. I can't tell you how your heart is. I can't tell if you have unforgiveness in your heart, or if you're joyous, or if you're glad, or if you're celebrating. But to bring it before this morning for communion, you need to examine your heart to see if you're right with God before you can actually think about taking communion. Let's find out what they did in communion, and you'll understand where I'm coming from this morning a little bit more. In Corinthians 17, now the following instructions. This was to the Corinthian church. This is not to our church. This was to the Corinthian church, it says. Now in the following instructions, I do not commend you. Because when you come together, it is not for better, but for worse. For to begin with, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and to some extent, I believe it. Indeed, there have to be fractions among you, for only will it become clear then who among you are genuine. When you come together, it is not really to eat the Lord's Supper at all. For when the time comes to eat, each of you goes ahead with your own supper. And one goes hungry, and another becomes drunk. What? Do you not have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you show contempt for the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What should I say to you? Should I commend you? In this matter, I do not commend you. It's hard for us to believe that a church would act that way, that a people would act that way and come together and celebrate and not really fully understand what communion is all about. But they were. And Paul knew that they were going to be sick and ill because they were not honoring the Lord God Almighty. They were not honoring the Lord Jesus Christ at all. They were just having a party. And communion was not to be about a party. Communion was to be about humbling oneself before the Lord God and before the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm sure Paul was very upset with their behavior. I thought he did a really fine job of explaining to them of what they were doing wrong. Because they didn't care about other people either. It sounds like they would bring their own lunch, and if you had lunch, that's fine, but if your neighbor was starving, that didn't make any difference. He didn't count. So it was somebody needed to teach. And Paul stood up to teach. What is your heart like for communion? The institution of the Lord's Supper. We find the words of Christ. But Paul says, personally, for this, for I received from the Lord Jesus what I also handed on to you. I have taught all of you. This is not what I have taught you. That the Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread and broke it. And when he had given thanks, he said to them, "This is my body that is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, that night, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This is my cup of the new covenant of my blood. Do this and as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often, every time, you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. This is of holy, holy importance. Paul's heart, when you read this, Paul's heart is going out to those within his congregation, within his church, that are not following after the example of Christ, that are still following the world. And his heart is heavy about that, because he doesn't want to lose them back to the world either, because this is such a special time. Communion is a holy time when we come. And it goes on with it. Whoever so eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be answerable for the body and the blood of Christ, which means you will be partakers in that act where the body and the blood of Christ was destroyed, not physically, but spiritually. We will have part of that. So it says again, examine yourselves. Only then eat the bread and drink the cup. For all who eat and drink without discerning the body, eat and drink judgment against themselves. Nobody else is doing your part. This is your part. You are the only one that can answer to this and how you speak with the Lord. For this reason, many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. Can anybody imagine that when you're coming together to eat and gorge yourself on the food and you're drinking the wine, you definitely know that you, when you're getting drunk, you definitely know that you are not after the Spirit of the Lord God. You are after your own worldly body and what you want. And so you can understand why some would be ill, because they don't know the Spirit of the Lord either. They don't know his promises and all the things that go along with knowing Christ. And Paul is really, he's really telling them here. So that's why many of you are weak. And many of you are ill and some have died. Because you're doing all of the things that look like you're part of the body of Christ, and yet you're having nothing to do with him at all. So our world is that way. We know that. We know there are many Christians that call themselves Christians, but no judging, but they are moving in with this group. And our heart grieves for them too, because we know when we do this, or when they do it, there's illness that can follow and death that can follow with that. So today, what we're doing is a holy, holy sacrament unto the Lord. And he wants our hearts in the right place. You can almost hear him up there rejoicing in heaven saying, "Yes, me, go for me. I have this. So, but if we judge ourselves, we're not asking other people to judge us. We do not want other people to judge us, because their judgment's a lot of times not too great either. But if we judge ourselves, because we know what we have done, we know those times when we should have been, when we should have forgiven and we haven't. And so, and it is amazing sometimes how things can come back up that happened years ago. And we can get upset about them, even if they happened 20 or 30 years ago. And we can get upset about them yet. Does that mean we've forgiven them? I know I had to deal with that this week. What am I doing? I'm getting upset about something that happened 30 years ago. How dumb is that? I need to just wipe it off my memory bank and say, no, that's fine. They're forgiven. And I'm forgiving myself for being so silly, for carrying it for this long. But search yourselves. That's what today, that's what Paul says. Look into your own hearts. Don't let other people tell you, but look into your own hearts and see what is there. So, but if we judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are also disciplined. A word that most of us are not too crazy to hear, the word discipline. But did you not discipline your children when they were little? And why did you discipline? Just because you enjoyed doing that? No. No. You discipline them for their safety and for the love that you have in your heart for them. The same reason that Christ disciplines us is we're walking astray and he wants to say, wait a minute, back, back. So listen, his discipline is truth and it is holy. And it's for forever correcting us. So don't ignore it either. Keep your ears open to that little nudge inside that said, I shouldn't have done that. Forgive yourself and forgive the other person also. And walk in the fullness of the Lord Jesus Christ. You don't stay there. You move on into glory and majesty and the power of the Lord Jesus Christ, because he's standing there with you. So, okay. Okay. So then, brothers and sisters, when you come together, eat, wait for one another. And if you are hungry, eat at home, so that when you come together, it will be for your commendation. Again, do this in remembrance of me. This is my body that is for you. This is the cup of the new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you drink and eat, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. From the bread and from the wine, we celebrate the Lord God. Every time we take this, we celebrate him. A little bit of admonition from Paul this morning. And it's so important, because sometimes we get so used to doing communion. And sometimes we even say, oh, it's Communion Sunday. And we should say, oh, it's Communion Sunday. It's a Sunday to come together and worship and bow before the Lord in that and worship him and praise him as we partake of the body and the blood of Christ this morning. This morning we're going to, I want to just do this. Before we begin, the body of Christ, broken for all of us. As we take communion this morning, I'm going to offer you to take a piece of the body of Christ from this loaf. Just pick out part of it. And that's for you. I want you to feel the same way that the disciples felt when Christ says to them, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat and do this in remembrance of me." And they partook of that, but they would have had to take a piece of the bread for themselves. And usually I have us all wait to the end to do this. So we do it in communion with one another. But today I'm going to ask if you will do it singly when you take the bread, eat. Because that is between you and the Lord. And it is a private and a personal thing. So this morning when we come up for the kneeling rail, please know this is where we're going with this. That you can feel the same way the disciples felt as Christ gave them the bread to share with one another. As you can see in our bulletin, I can locate mine again. I put our prayer confession, therefore a reason that it was after the message as Paul gave to them, as Christ gives to us. So please join one together in the prayer of confession. Gracious God, we pray for forgiveness this holy day where we were not served. Fill us with your Spirit where we have not loved. Transform us with your loving ways, where we have not forgiven. Grace us with your repentance, where we have rejected offers and chances. Give us yet more chance. Lift us up and guide us forward. Amen. The words of assurance is that we know that the Lord God has looked at each heart that is here and soul that is here, and he's heard the words spoken and unspoken. He is here with arms wide open to grace us this morning for celebrating the life of his precious, precious Son, Jesus Christ. Between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we do celebrate this. Father, please. Our prayer of confession before you, Lord. We thank you. In the name of Christ, amen. I would ask us to please stand and sing before we take communion. Let us break bread together on our knees.
Thank you.
The communion rail is open to all who would like to come. None are held back. To partake in Jesus and his precious life-giving blood and body, we do this in full remembrance of our Lord Jesus Christ. Please come forward.
A place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all the
Christ has looked. The Lord God has searched your heart and your soul. And you have come forward to partake of his body and his blood. Be washed and cleansed and made whole and forgiven. Rise and go as the saints of the living God. Peace.
I will feast at the table of the Lord.
will feast at the table of the Lord. I won't hunger anymore at his table. I will feast at the table of the Lord. I will feast at the table of the Lord. And I won't hunger anymore at his table. Come on, you. Is all creation groaning?
Presence of the Lord Jesus Christ is here. The Holy Spirit is here because we have honored all of them. We have honored the Trinity with our presence, with our songs, with our hallelujahs, and with our being here and sharing in the body and the blood of Christ. Please know how blessed you really are this day, in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Does anyone have a testimony from this past week or something that they would like to share what God has done in their lives? So, we have Chris back home from vacation, or from our mission trip, so she will be speaking with us in the future, and so I'm excited to hear that and for testimony that was down. So anybody got anything this morning? Okay, Bev. Amen. Prayers are answered. Over and over. Anybody else? Pam.
So I was testimony. So when I was working, and this guy was coming in to clean the pump up, and he came past me, and he looked like, you know, like really got me, you know, whatever. So then, 2 seconds, or a couple minutes later, he's driving back home, and he couldn't get to the the 50s. So I said, I will go with you and we will move what we need to move so you can clean it. And as he was going up to the 50, he was asking me about how much I made, you know, and he said each equipment is different. And he was like, oh, I talked to some culvert guys, they make like $45-$50. I said, well, maybe you'll have to jump ship. I said, do it. And he's like, nope, I can't do that. I go to church. And I was like, okay, I go to church too. And, you know, there's a lot of ruckus going on the job site. And he was like, I have been in prison and I've been And I said, everyone does. And I said, you don't see that in this neck of the woods, you know, construction working and whatever. And as he was driving away from me and he was looking kind of back out his window, he said, you have to plant the seed. You might not see it grow, but you plant the seed, because if you don't, and I said, the enemy wins, but the enemy doesn't win. And he went. So a testimony to nowadays, to even if you don't feel right saying it to someone, plant the seed.
Plant the seed. Stir the soil. Jim.
My cousin David has back to Texas small one. I just want prayers for him as a safe trip back.
Okay.
I mean, all our kids are going back to school. Yeah.
Kids going back to school. Pray for the teachers, okay?
Yeah.
And for the administrators. And so, cover them dearly.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
We have our son-in-law who was admitted to the hospital with diabetic complications. So, we ask for him.
A name?
Chris.
Chris, that's all right. And Janet, can you share with us how Jeff is doing?
Jeff has a mom from the hospital on Thursday night. He's doing fine. He has two viral infections.
Yep.
Very, very sick.
Okay. He had. And spread over the next week. So, had Jeff, her son had two infections that were fighting each other, actually, and making him really bad. But he is back home now. He came home Thursday, and he's doing really, really fine. And he wanted to thank the chair for all the prayers that were said. So, you know, sometimes we don't see it, but it's out there. It's truly out there. So, anything else this morning?
Yeah, we're blessed with a birthday today. Janet has a birthday.
Ah, okay. Well, this is part of the adoption into the family. Okay.
We need to sing happy birthday.
Okay.
A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. May you feel Jesus here every day of the year. Happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. God bless you.
So, okay, let us go to prayer for a while, and we want to thank you, Lord, for watching over Bev, Lord, as her journey gets pretty struggling sometimes. We thank you for walking with her, and for Pam's testimony, oh Lord, of how a word that we don't think is really important can be the most important word in the person's life altogether. Give us that boldness, O Lord, to speak out, to plant that seed in a gentle way. But sometimes it's not so gentle. When the Lord nudges us, we need to move and say, do you know Christ? You know, I'm a Christian. Start with that. And maybe your response will be different, but start it anyway. It has to begin someplace, and it might as well begin with you, oh Lord. And oh Lord, we pray for James, who is on his way to Texas. We ask for your protection round about him for the whole way, oh Lord, and whatever it may be, that you protect him and that you keep him safe, that he returns home to Texas, and that you protect him also in Texas. And Lord, we pray for Texas, that your help and your assistance would be there with all those that come in, O Lord. It is devastating. We ask for your presence there, O Lord, to make it a place where people are not dying all over the place. O Lord, in your mercy and in your grace, we thank you. And we pray for Chris this morning, O Lord, with his diabetes complications. We ask as the body of Christ who has been cleansed and have taken the communion and holy and righteous, that your hand will be upon him right now at this moment as we pray, that the healing of the Lord Jesus Christ will be upon him, that you will give the doctors whatever, the wisdom that they need, but mostly that Chris will surprise them by the healing of the Lord Jesus Christ in his body, and that we celebrate, oh Lord, that we celebrate. Another seed planted there, even in a hospital, Lord. And for that we rejoice and we thank you. In your precious name, amen. So, okay. Now, as the Lord has taught us to pray, please, yeah. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
God bless. Thank you. You can't read and write at the same time, talk at the same time. So please, at this time, we'll receive our gifts and our offerings. Lord, your word says you love a cheerful giver. Lord, we give these gifts unto you cheerfully, and we just enjoy your presence here with us this day, and we thank you. In the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, amen. God bless. So, our closing hymn, 3 Standing 4, 374. Standing on the promises.
Standing on the promises of God, standing.
We definitely are standing on the promises of God. Go in the grace and the peace and the love of the Lord Jesus Christ, knowing that His blessings have been showered upon you this morning because you came, and you came and accepted His Son's sacrifice that He sent Him to sacrifice for us. And the Lord smiles upon you. Go in the grace and the mighty power of the Lord Jesus Christ, filled with the Holy Spirit as God guides and directs your feet and your voice and all of you. In His precious name we pray. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, hallelujah and amen. God bless.